And so we'll start out with a brief personal background about you and your family settlement in Oregon.
All right. I'm a native Oregonian, which is a little bit rare.
That is.
grew up in Newburgh, and then our family moved to over in Polk County, Marion County, mm-hmm. and we had a farm there out of St. Paul.
Okay.
But my father was a school administrator. That was his profession.
Good job, yeah.
And he got me interested in majoring in forestry, which I did. Mm-hmm. I started out in political science at Willamette and then transferred to Oregon State and graduated in forest management.
Okay. And that was back when? Sorry.
60. When would I have graduated? 62 or 3.
Okay.
Right in there.
Okay.
Those are the little details you forget.
Right.
But in this context, it may be a little bit important, I don't know. But anyway, so I was very interested in forestry, and I was very interested in the state legislature. And so I was seeking a job and got one where I was lobbying at the Oregon legislature, originally for Associated Oregon Industries, and they established a forest division, mm-hmm. which I ran.
Okay.
And then we split away from AOI and formed the Oregon Forest Industries Council, okay. of which I was president.
OFIC.
Uh-huh. OFIC.
Okay.
And in the meantime, I had worked for Weyerhauser, and we moved up to Federal Way, and then we moved back here to take that job with OFIC.
Okay.
And I'm not sure when that would have been, in the 68 or something like that.
Okay.
Does that sound right?
Yeah, could be. Were you working in your capacity with the legislature when Senate Bill 10
yes.
was passed? Okay.
It started with Senate Bill 10. Right. I don't know how much you want to. I could maybe even help best in those early days.
Yeah.
Senate Bill 10 was the precursor.
Right.
The initiator of that was State Senator Joe. Is that right?
I don't remember. I had just started my planning career in 72, and I was in Douglas County as a planner. I graduated from the University of Washington Planning and got a job in Douglas County, and we were responsible for implementing Senate Bill 10, so
okay.
I'm always interested.
Well, it started with Senate Bill 10, and the interesting thing about that is that it was agriculture-driven.
Right.
It was the agriculture interests that were worried about the development of Oregon and wanted to protect farmland.
Right.
Valuable farmland. So that was the precursor, and it was I can't remember his name, either a state senator or state representative from Polk County. I do remember
okay.
that.
Okay.
And it passed, I believe, Senate Bill 10.
Right.
But it was pretty inadequate in terms of its scope and its purpose. And so in 1, 2, and 3, work started on Senate Bill 100. And there were several people that were key to that. Mm-hmm. I suppose the primary one was State Senator L.B. Day. Mm-hmm. And he appointed a committee to work toward that goal. So I think
now, is this a legislative committee or is it the subcommittee? I've read a little bit about.
Well, he was a state senator.
Right.
And he formed a Senate Bill 100 Committee.
Okay.
So that was not of legislators.
Right. It was the interest of
the interest. He tried to bring the interests together.
Right.
The other person that was a very strong element of the early days was Gail Ackerman.
Okay.
In the governor's office.
Uh-huh.
So she took a personal interest.
Okay.
On behalf of Governor Neil Goldsmith, I guess.
Well, yeah, Neil came later, I know. Let's see, McCall would have been the governor when Senate Bill 100 was passed, and then Governor Straub was an advocate, I think, of the same
right.
program, pretty much.
Right, but Gail was on, I thought, Neil Goldsmith's
yeah,
staff.
Yeah, I think she was. I think that's correct.
As a natural resource advisor.
Right, she was.
Okay. So she staffed this...
I see. She was before Goldsmith. She worked in the legislature before she got to Neil Goldsmith's office.
No, she on behalf of Neil Goldsmith.
Okay,
she was on his personal staff.
Okay.
As a natural resource.
Neil, at the time Senate Bill 100 was passed, I think Neil Goldsmith was mayor of Portland still, if I remember.
Okay, that's probably right.
Yeah, so it would have been... My understanding would be, of course, L.B. Day, Hector McPherson from the agriculture.
Of course. Hector was
a driving
force
in this. Ted Halleck was, I know, instrumental. I read a lot. I didn't meet him, but I read
Well, not in terms of the effective advocates,
uh-huh.
it was Hector McPherson, for
right,
sure,
right.
and L.B. Day right. and Gail Ackerman. However, we pieced that together
yeah,
when
okay.
she came in to chair this ad hoc committee.
Okay. Do you remember any of the other members of the committee?
Well, I've been trying to think about that, and if you could refresh my memory of names.
Well, I'm not sure. I looked through the book, and I didn't pick anybody out in particular. Your name's in here, as well as Hector's and some of the LB, of course. And I'm guessing, I don't know whether Henry Richmond was doing something back then.
Well, he was more off to the side. He
okay.
was very interested.
Right.
And whether he was a member of that committee, I don't think he was.
Okay.
But, let me think.
Do you remember the, kind of the controversy going around? Was Senate Bill 100 something that obviously a majority passed it, so they accepted it, but I don't know what the compromises were when they were talking. Senate Bill 10, and I know from my own personal experience of the things that didn't work with Senate Bill 10, there was a disconnect between the comprehensive planning and the zoning,
right.
and a lot of people shot out and did the zoning and never really looked at the overall comprehensive approach,
right.
and sometimes the zones didn't match up with the plans, and so there was a lot of concerns back then. And so I'm guessing that the reason Senate Bill 100 came to pass was because Senate Bill 10 wasn't working well enough.
Correct. It was not broad enough, it was not comprehensive enough,
yeah.
and it was not a comprehensive program. In the view of Senate Bill 100, one of the things about Senate Bill 100 in its original form,
mm-hmm.
it was statewide. It was to apply to all lands.
Right, okay.
Regardless of their use.
Uh-huh.
And it was to, which we had never had before.
Right.
And that's one reason it was so controversial, because it was imposing or threatened to impose restrictions on how land could be used.
Right.
Everywhere. So every county was required to come up with a plan and protect one way or another these goals.
Right, the
now these goals were 1 through 19, I guess.
Yeah.
But originally...
One through 14 was
one the, through 14.
And the coastal the, goals got added
yeah.
a few years later.
They were later.
Yeah.
And... I think it was really almost through goal 12 that we were concerned about and even more narrowly than that.
Now, what I was reading in Cy Adler's book here, like I said, you're quoted in here a few times, it was interesting because when they were first talking about adopting the goals, forestry was kind of an afterthought. Maybe they didn't think it needed protection, or I don't know, but somebody must have raised their hand and said, wait a minute, if you're going to protect agricultural lands, forestry needs to...
Well, I think my organization was a key one in getting forestry included.
Oh, good. I'd like to hear about that.
And there is a reason, because it was a little bit controversial within the forest products industry.
Right.
But my organization, OFIC, did advocate and supported Senate Bill 100. And we had a purpose, and our purpose was to protect forest land from development.
Okay.
For two reasons. One, it had a risk. If you allowed development in forest land, you increased the risk of fire.
Right.
Which was quite huge.
Yes.
For us. And the other was, as people moved into the forest zone, their activities often were inconsistent with forest activities, and what they would do would be to organize efforts to stop forestry.
Right.
It was either noisy or dusty or disruptive.
Right. You'd be destroying their scenery.
and scenery.
Yeah.
So it was, you know, there was a real clash of values.
Yes.
And that's what kept OFIC involved in the process throughout this, was to try to preserve those
definitely
purposes.
I recall one of the discussions that we had many times before the commission was the fact that the industry had a long-term investment, and to be committed to that investment, you had to have some certainty.
Exactly.
That by the end of 80 years or however long you needed to let the trees grow before they could be harvested, was that you had to be sure that the public understood that was what forestry was about.
And that was a big breach in understanding, because people were attracted to live in the forest land.
Oh, absolutely.
And they wanted to buy land for development. And as soon as they did, they didn't want any forestry, commercial forestry,
right,
to go on around them.
Right.
So that was a ongoing conflict.
Do you remember the actual discussions of the writing of Goal 4, Forest Lands? I know the book credits you with actually coming up with some of the language, or actually the language.
Well, probably thing. Was. Do you have it handy? Is it relevant?
Well, I don't know that it's relevant. I think I'm just, I mean.
But the thing is, it was, we were very interested in how that language was worded.
Right.
And one of the things we were concerned about was the goal was not to preserve forest land.
Okay.
And that word is a key word.
Yes. Yeah, in fact, conserve forest land for forest uses was the strength of the goal statement.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then at the time, I recall that unlike the agriculture goal, which ended up being tied to exclusive farm use zoning, and the legislature got involved in actually prescribing the uses on agriculture land, I don't think forestry wanted to go that far. And
I think you're right. I don't. My memory's hazy there, but I think you're
and
right.
And so the goal started out more as an inventory goal?
Yes.
Okay, because, and then there were some discussions I remember as a young planter trying to get the inventories necessary, and it was difficult to, you know, actually, as you go through a county and try to identify an inventory all of your forest lands, that process was more difficult than I guess I expected it at the time.
Yes, and that was a goal of ours, was to inventory
and try to do something more uniform around the state, as opposed to having different inventories that didn't match and you wouldn't know where.
Correct. And we had several partners, important partners. One was Oregon State University, and the other was the Forest Service and BLM.
Correct.
Yeah. Who they had to cooperate in that. And I said the State Department, the Forestry, you know,
Right.
Surely. They were, and Jim Brown, who's this, maybe not the original state forest when this started, but very soon.
Right. But he was on staff. I think he was very involved.
I think, yeah, there's another predecessor of Jim Brown, but Jim was very committed to and very helpful to
yes.
this process.
Yeah, all the way through. I know we spent many, I spent a lot of time with the Department of Forestry people.
I bet you did, of course, because Douglas County was, it was and is a forest county.
Yeah, for sure. Just an aside, do you remember Ray Dorner?
Oh, of course.
Okay, yeah.
Ray we worked together very closely.
Al Flagle and Ray Dorner were, and Stanford Buell were the first commissioners that I, when I was employed there.
Uh-huh.
And of course, Ray was ONC, kind of chairman of ONC.
He was the chairman of ONC, the yeah. ONC counties.
And, you know, very committed mm-hmm. to forestry.
Ray was a real leader in helping to guide the counties
yeah.
in these goals.
Yeah, well, he was a real good county commissioner, too, for mm-hmm. for us.
When I'm sure he would have been.
Let's see, well, I should get back to the question. let's see, of the 19 statewide planning goals, which goals do you believe have been the most important to accomplishing the objectives of the state land use program? And which ones do you feel the least?
One that was a disappointment, I think, and it was one that I was, there was a citizen involvement committee.
Yes.
Of which I was a member.
Okay.
And we held hearings around the state. The purpose of citizen involvement was felt to be critical to the success of the program,
uh-huh.
but it didn't work.
In what way? I mean,
well, it just fizzled. It just, at least, I think, in terms of how it was supposed to work. Now, somebody else might see that differently.
Sure.
But that just, that's my observation.
Yeah, how many years, you remember how many years you were on that or involved with citizens?
Well, I was on it as kind of long as it was effective. I'd say 4 years.
Okay.
Not more than that.
And do you think it was, I know in the general public sense, it's hard to get people excited about land use planning because it doesn't, even though it may affect their daily lives, it doesn't touch them, you know, every day.
Yeah. One of the reasons that citizen involvement had difficulties was that the counties viewed it as infringing on their jurisdiction.
Okay.
They thought that was their job.
Yeah.
As county commissioners in our county to involve citizens. So it looked to them, and they almost expressed it this way.
Yeah.
It was an infringement on their prerogatives.
Okay.
So it was not allowed to give an
interest. As was the state land use program. I'm sure I know. You know, many counties weren't thrilled about having the state oversee.
Yes, that's true. There were a lot of built-in conflicts
yeah.
with Senate Bill 100, and that's one of them.
Yeah. Did you, as your involvement with OFIC, did you work with county commissioners quite a bit then?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And do you remember any particular county or county commissioners that were either for land use or, you know, were a little bit hostile towards it?
Not in that sense, probably.
But you had many discussions about land use in your meetings, probably.
Yeah. You know, we weren't as close or interactive with AOC as I think maybe your question implied.
Yeah. You'd be involved with Forest counties and
primarily
probably ONC
and the yeah counties. But ONC had their own organization,
right,
of which Ray Dorner was chairman.
Okay.
And other staff that they hired were, so we didn't really deal with that.
So they didn't come to you for information or
no.
Okay.
No.
And your organization represented mostly the industrial.
Yeah, well, the breakup or the bounds of our jurisdiction, if you will,
uh-huh.
was state and private lands.
Okay.
Not federal.
Okay.
So we were actively involved in Salem lobbying for state forest policy.
Right.
But we never went back to Washington, D.C. ONC counties did.
Right.
And the association, well, the national organizations was NACO. Do you remember who they were?
Yeah.
National
Association of Counties.
Association of Counties.
Yeah.
Who lobbied on all county issues.
Okay.
In Washington, D.C. The ONC counties, of course, were just...
For federal. You know, yeah, and that was a federal county relationship.
Yeah.
So.
So we didn't...
You didn't get drawn into that.
No. Moment. We were very careful to conserve our resources where it would make the most good and not conflict with somebody else.
Right.
And especially if there's a risk of policy differences.
Yeah.
And one way we kept that clean was that we dealt with private lands, state and private lands.
Right.
Not federal. With one exception, and that exception was fire. Because federal fire policy did impact the counties.
Right.
And us, and the industrial landowners, very much. So.
So you had support for a budget issue regarding
mm-hmm.
having money for fighting wildfires.
Yes,
yeah.
Absolutely.
That
and
makes sense.
And the policies toward forest policy. There's a big issue during some of those years, maybe raising its head again, let burn.
Right, right.
And of course we were totally opposed to that.
Yeah.
So, and that's one area where we had our conflicts with the environmental community.
Sure. Which go on today still.
Yeah, even and most of, now, for the most part though, we work collaboratively with the Oregon Environmental Council. Mm-hmm. Because some of our goals were similar.
Right.
And one was to preserve forest land.
And of course, preserving forest lands would also preserve habitat and other things.
Of course.
Yeah.
And then that's where Senate Bill 100 had became rather specific. And that's where we had some problems.
Right.
With Senate Bill 100.
Or goal 5, goal 4.
Goal 5,
yes. Right.
For sure. And as it began to be words put down on paper and what it really meant, we became very uncomfortable with some of that language.
Yeah. Ultimately, that ended up getting resolved. I think it was House Bill 3396. And
that number sounds familiar.
Yeah, and I think you were.
What was it?
3396. That ended up, in fact, too bad Jim wasn't still here because
he was very much involved.
He was in the middle of that. Jim was charged at the time with the agency to evaluate, I think, the Oregon Forest Practices Act to determine whether it met the statewide planning goals.
Right, and that was some area where we had some conflict.
Right,
too.
He did an analysis that I recall fondly now because most of the people that we at forestry were like.
Well, I had my problems with.
Yeah,
that.
I'm sure you did. I'm sure you did.
And when was the analysis he made?
That's a good question. I want to say it's like. Could have been 91 or 93 in that general.
Could have been, yeah. Could have been, very likely.
Anyway, and that's when Gail Achterman and Neil Goldschmidt was governor at the time.
That's maybe when she came in.
And I think
in.
She had to be the arbiter of how we're doing.
And she did a fabulous job
of
bringing people together and getting them to accept and coalesce around, was it that bill or was it a different bill?
I think it might have been that one. That number sticks in my head. I could be wrong.
It does to me, too.
I think,
don't remember the specifics of it.
I remember part of it in that it ended up revising the Board of Forestry.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It ended up, basically, one of the issues I remember was that timber industry, probably OFIC, didn't want to have 36 individual forest practices acts. They need to have a uniform application.
Yeah, and the really the instigator of that conflict was Tillamook County.
Yes.
That tried to impose their own forest regulation. And
right,
we were,
of course,
opposed to that.
I recall that starting the the dialogue.
I had something else I was going to add to that. That was germane to that, but well, okay. One of our fundamental goals was that if you abided by the Oregon Forest Practices Act, you were in compliance with environmental protection for habitat.
Right. That was the outcome of that legislation.
Yeah, that was.
And basically, you met goal 5 if you met the Forest Practices Act.
Correct.
And of course, it was revised in a major way to go a little farther in protecting some of the environmental.
Yes, in what would it have been?
In fact, at the time, it was leading the nation. It was really a, a kind of a watershed.
And we expanded it with our support.
Yeah.
The scope of the regulation under the Forest Practices Act.
Right.
Regulating the size of clear cuts. How that could be done. We created, in fact, I have a question I was going to ask the state forester at some point, because we go to Tillamook or Seaside frequently.
Oh, yeah.
And which has always been a hotbed of controversy of this very nature.
Right.
It seems to me the compromises that we worked out and put into law have not been carried out.
Oh, is that right?
We had what was called the Scenic Highway Act.
Yeah.
Do you remember that?
Uh-huh.
Is it still on the books?
I suspect so, yeah. I haven't spent
any
time looking at it.
It's not being implemented.
Oh, isn't it? Is it, which corridor you happen to be in?
26.
Okay.
And we're on Highway 26 a lot, which is an interesting mix of private land and state land, of course.
Right.
But the law, the Scenic Highways Act, applied to both. And there were certain named highways.
Correct. Yeah, I remember seeing
that. We picked ones that were key all over the state.
Right.
And Highway 26 was one.
Right.
And so the goal was to protect a strip.
Kind of the viewshed.
A viewshed. Right. Now, we didn't ban harvesting.
Right.
But we scheduled, you had to be scheduled. So I can't remember the distance. Was it 300 feet or?
I don't know. I didn't work on that myself.
I can't remember the specifics.
I know there's a buffer.
We took that buffer and divided it. And you had to either harvest in the first half of that and then not touch the strip behind it, or vice versa.
I see. Okay.
And you had to wait till the land greened up.
Right. You gave it time to grow back. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's not being followed.
You see some bad spots.
Oh, it's terrible. Yeah. In fact, do you go on that highway?
I haven't been for a while. We used to go quite a bit. But when we go to, I've been up to Seaside, but I usually take the, I go on down towards
Hebo
and go up through there.
Well, we go on Highway 26 because it's almost always faster.
Yeah, that's true.
And we go a lot. And it just, if you ever have a chance, make it point of it.
Okay.
Because it's ugly. It is just abominable.
Well.
There's slash piled.
Really?
Within several hundred yards of the highway.
Huh.
And it stayed there.
That's
been there for
two or three
years. And it's supposed to be, it should have been burned and replanted. And nothing's been.
Now, my last time, I remember some cuts when I drove down 26, but I think it was very recent, and so I kind of gave them the benefit of the doubt. I did.
Well, there's nothing against harvesting.
Yeah.
But the requirement of the Forest Practices Act is that you have to get green up within.
Clean up after yourself.
And get green up within
plant.
7 years.
Have they planted back, do you think?
Or? Oh, no. No way.
Really?
No.
Oh, wow. I see Ted Lawrenson once in a while. Do you remember Ted?
Very well, and ask him that.
I will.
He's probably retired.
Yes, he is.
But ask him that.
Okay. Yeah, he would know, and know who to talk to.
I've forgotten right now, what's the name of the current state board?
Is it Doug Decker? Is he still there?
Doug Decker.
Okay.
In fact, do you have a pen?
Yeah, yeah, call Doug.
How much of this can I keep?
You can keep the whole thing. You call Doug, and if you say something, Doug will listen to you.
Oh, I'm sure he will. Doug is a very good guy, and yeah. I was very pleased with his appointment.
I left just before, I think Jim was still director, if I remember right. And then Jim went on to be governor's assistant. Mm-hmm. And I worked with Ted and Gary Lettman and Kevin and Jim quite a bit towards the latter part of
Jim's tenure.
Yeah, and of our tenure here. Jim Knight and I and Craig Greenleaf, we were all working on Goal 4 issues. We had to amend the goal from the early days.
On forest lands?
Mostly because of the way we'd implemented it for the longest time was through acknowledgement reviews. And then LUBA court cases would come in and make changes to interpretations. And we...
Is that where my problem got wrapped up?
Well, your problem with 3396 or the...
Which, no, it's how it's being implemented.
Oh, I don't think so, because that's...
For the city highways.
Yeah, that's... No, that wasn't... We didn't control that anyway. Anyway, the need to amend Goal 4, it got to the point where we couldn't, it didn't appear consistent enough through the acknowledgement process. And so the only way to reshuffle the deck, if you will, was to amend the goal itself and amend the language of the goal from the original goal. And so by doing that, we aligned what basically the state policy was regarding land use planning for Goal 4.
Can you be specific?
Yeah, in fact, I have the goal. Let's see, I think I brought a copy of the goal here.
Is it in any of this?
No, I think I have it here. Oh, here it is. This is what the goal reads now. And you'll see, it used to say to conserve forest lands for forest uses. And then it had a discussion about inventorying forest lands. And now, of course, it has a whole, it's just a different... It basically recognizes acknowledged forest lands as forest lands. So, and then if you want to amend that, there's a process there it establishes. So basically it's that highlighted.
Is the new language?
It's the current language for Goal 4. You'll notice it's different than probably your statement that was adopted by the commission. And since that was adopted, I think things have stabilized. I don't hear a lot of controversies about Goal 4 per se. There are other things that have gone on. This ended up also, I think it was the same time, they ended up doing a test for dwellings in forest lands. And I think it stabilized the situation better.
Yeah.
There's a template test now. If you have a certain number of dwellings, and you have land to infill around it, you can go ahead and infill it, but you can't go off in, into establishing a whole bunch of homes in uncharted areas.
Well, I'll read this.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, there's got to be some changes that have prompted my problem. Either you're indicating it might be a court case, I don't know. It might be a change in their policy of implementation. It certainly is contrary to the law.
You may want to talk to Doug and to see
what's
happened, or maybe it's just enforcement. Maybe they don't have people.
Well, that is very possible.
They may not have the funding to have people go out and check very carefully.
Yeah. Because the law was firm, and if you didn't do it, the department was directed to go in and do it and charge the land.
That's right. I remember that. Yeah. I don't know.
That's a pretty awesome thing, and they may be reluctant to do that.
Yeah, we'll check with them. I think that would be good that you do that. Okay, let me go back to our questions here. Do you believe the statewide planning goal struck the balance between state and local control that LCDC intended in 1974?
The balance of what?
The balance between state and local control. You remember we talked a little bit about the counties wanting, probably feeling the state was intruding.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the goals were trying to, if I recall, or you probably know better than I, when they were designed, they wanted a balance. They wanted the state to have an interest and their interest addressed, but they wanted the decision making to be done at the local
level.
That's
correct. That's correct.
And do you think that's worked?
I have no way of knowing.
Okay.
That there's no question but what that was the purpose, and our purpose was to have that balance.
Okay.
I have, I'm just not privy to any information about that. That's a good question.
I guess because the program's still here, it's working well enough, but I'm sure if you talk to counties, my sense is that people have accepted land use regulations pretty well. I mean, we've had our controversies with ballot measures and such.
Yes.
But in the long run, I think the regulations are generally relatively understood, and people don't complain. I don't hear the complaints I used to hear about it. No, I'm not.
And I'm not, I'm not where I would.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm too far removed. I would have been.
When did you retire from OFIC?
In 1998.
Okay.
Fairly recently. Yeah. That was, well, it's more and more time.
Yeah, you were about 5 years before me, I think. I don't, I'll be honest, I don't keep up with it as much as I certainly used to when we were working. So it's, I'll read the paper and try to figure things out. Talk to...
If I see a headline that relates to those days, I'll read it or an article. But I have no inside information about what interest groups are doing.
Yeah, same here. So that's kind of the same thing. So the next question may be also along the same lines, a little bit difficult to work with. How do you think Oregon's land use program in 2015 compares with what was envisioned 4 decades ago?
That's pretty hard because I don't have the information. Okay. I would be very interested in what anybody has come up with in the way of an evaluation of that question.
Yeah.
But I can't make that.
We'll probably have to watch some of these interviews of other people and get that.
More current interviews would help that quite a bit.
Yeah. Are there any changes or additions you'd like to see in our planning laws and statewide goals to enable Oregon's land use program to face the challenges of the future?
Well, there is one, and it's one I felt back when I was still working. I think there is a lack of balance. There's a goal related to this on urban development.
Okay.
Because I think Senate Bill 100, if it has a fault in people of my persuasion, it is that it favors too much environmental protection at the expense of good economic development.
Okay.
And there needs to be room for both. Well managed.
Right.
But both.
Okay.
And I think that's been left out. That dimension of Senate Bill 100 has not been adequate.
The overall strategy, of course, was to try and put in development in urban growth boundaries in the in urbanized areas, and every city in the county, I'm sorry, every city in the state has an urban growth boundary.
Mm-hmm.
But
urban growth boundaries don't totally address my concern.
Okay.
Urban growth boundaries are great. I support them. They try to keep growth within a boundary.
Right.
But some of the economic implications of land use planning go outside the city boundary.
Right.
And that's where there's a conflict.
Okay. That's a good point. Let's see. Some Oregon land use observers believe that the approval of Senate Bill 100 was possible because of the time period in which we live, the 1970s and the birth of the environmental movement. The enactment occurred because of the convergence of four key factors: A, a vision; B, leadership; C, federal money; and D, luck. What do you think? Is that?
I think that's a good summary.
Do you agree or disagree, or believe that there were any other factors that were critical to the passage of Senate Bill 100?
Well, I think timing is almost everything.
Okay.
In politics, the convergence of leaders who wanted it to happen, and there were strong leaders, and that's the way public policy almost always. Major public policy changes.
So the leaders you're talking about were Tom McCall, Governor
McCall.
Probably
people like Henry Richmond,
okay,
who were on the periphery.
Okay.
LB Day, for sure.
Right. Hector McPherson and
Hector?
Ted Halleck, because they ran the...
Well, Halleck, his fingerprints on... I hope I'm not doing him injustice. We're pretty faint.
He just wanted to get it through, right? That he wasn't.
Yeah.
He wasn't the author.
He was the overall chairman one day of that committee, and LB Day was appointed as.
But not the driving force.
No.
Okay, that's. I see your clarification there. Do you think it is possible that Senate Bill 100 would be passed today?
I don't know that I see but I'm not in a position to know.
Right.
The leadership, it takes strong leadership to create that kind of a sea change in public policy, and I don't know whether it exists today. I doubt if it does.
Okay.
The thing that keeps it going is inertia and momentum and hesitancy, and people will look to see if it's working.
Uh-huh.
But if you're starting scratch today, I'm not sure it could happen. Because you always run into, and Oregon is, and every Western state is this way. They have this abiding interest in the past,
uh-huh,
what they've done, whether they can do certain things with their land. And this is true of the West, obviously.
Uh-huh.
The West Coast has been a bastion of willingness to change. Washington State preceded us, and California, I don't know much about California, but. And then as soon as you move east, like Idaho and Colorado, you have less.
Right.
For sure. So I just
Is that driven by population growth and fear that it's going to change things for us too radically?
I think it depends on political leaders who see a different vision.
Okay.
That our political leaders did, and they were able to force it through. I don't know. You'd have to know a lot more in depth than I'd begin to know about other states.
Yeah. And it's interesting to me the composition of the politics back then, because you had a Republican governor and two Republican senators who were very strong on something that probably today, if I'm reading the tea leaves correct, would probably be reversed. I don't see the Republican legislature doing that. I mean, when I was there, they were a good watchdog.
Mm-hmm. And it was a collaborative group. It had its splits.
Yes.
Philosophically, for sure.
Yeah.
And all these concerns still existed then that we're talking about today. But then we had that political leadership that was powerful,
yeah,
enough to hang on to get something passed.
And far more bipartisan than,
yes,
what you have today.
Yeah.
Which is,
for sure.
Yeah.
I just don't see it today.
Yeah. Do you believe the state land use program is equipped to address and properly respond to major changes, examples being population growth, the economy, climate change, affordable housing, environment, over the next 40 years? Or do you think other additional changes are needed? Do you think we set a good framework for responding to?
Well, I think we have a framework. What choices will be made, none of us know.
Right.
But the framework is there if we don't toss it out. And of course, there's always that risk. In Oregon.
Yeah, I think the ballot measures have, I think that fervor has kind of subsided a little bit. I think there's, I tend to think there's, I'm not sure how to describe it, but just, I mean, not to say things aren't still there, but they've released the pressure a little bit, and I think there's a little bit of a balance.
Yeah, I think you must be right.
I don't note the controversy that we had when I was still with the department as much. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a good thing. I think there have been some concessions that probably have made the program more accepting for many.
Yes, I think that's true. Their threats really have not proven to be that much of a problem. Things they were concerned about.
Yeah.
And how we could deal with their land.
And do you think the industry fairly satisfied, you think, with timber industry is fairly satisfied with the program still today?
Is it? I have no reason to think they aren't.
Okay. And it did an adequate job of protecting resource lands or the forest lands in particular?
I believe so. There's quite different leadership at OFIC. I see.
Okay.
And that's why I'm really reluctant to...
You can't speak for them, of course.
Speak for them. Yeah. At all.
But when you were there, that was your...
Yes.
Your vision for it.
Yeah. Yeah.
What is your view about the future of Oregon's land use program? Do you believe Oregonians, kind of what we talked about, have accepted the state laws and will continue wanting cities and counties to plan for growth and protect resources through comprehensive planning and zoning?
I think so.
Yeah.
I believe so.
Okay. Well, do you have anything else you want to add to our discussion here?
Well, I'm awfully glad this review is going on, because I think it's a good way to test the temperature today.
Oh, that's good, yeah.
You know, if you're bringing in current leaders, not the past.
Right.
Which I assume that you're doing.
Right now, they've got a list of folks. They're trying to capture the history of the program is the first segment. To be honest, I don't know. I would like to see it continue. And I know they're meeting with a bunch of the planning directors about kind of the future of the program as well. And I'm going to be personally asking them to have us talk with some of the planners who were down in the trenches implementing this program, because I know what we went through. We've got, I think, some fascinating stories. If anyone in the future wants to grab the Oregon program model and start it up, I think they can avoid some of the pitfalls that
if they would just ask.
Right. So I'd like to see some of that captured as well, because plus there's many just interesting stories about people that were either instrumental in getting the state program off the ground or getting it off the ground locally in the sense of getting their plans adopted.
Yeah.
There's a lot of stories out there that are actually quite fascinating.
And there are some current issues, and I raised one on Highway 26. I'd be very curious about how those kind of controversies are being dealt with, if they are.
Yeah. Well, I will certainly ask Ted if I see him.
And I will ask.
You call Doug.
I'll talk to Doug.
And that would be great. Well, I don't have anything. I think we kind of got through the
Well, that's very comprehensive.
I'm glad you I'm glad you're willing to do it. And on behalf of, I know, Portland State and all of us interested in this project, I'm certainly glad you were.
Well, thank you.
Talk with us.
truly appreciate being asked. I feel kind of inadequate because it's been so long.
Well,
and I'm not up to date on the controversy or
right. I think what's nice is to kind of recount that history because we're first of all
that will be lost.
It will, and I was there, but I was in Douglas County. I didn't know how the legislation got through, and I wasn't here for Goal 4. I was here for one of the Goal 4 modifications, but I wasn't here for the initial adoption. And I think all of that is real interesting, and we want it captured for future generations.
Well, Oregon is such a diverse state, philosophically as well as the natural element of the land.
Yes.
And you just see that every day in public policy issues that may come up. I think OPB did a very interesting segment on the controversy over wolves.
Okay.
Did you see that?
I haven't. I've seen some of their shows.
Well, what they did, and did I say Douglas County? Grant County.
Okay.
And the Grant County decided to take the bull by the horns, if you will, and this controversy about banning the hunting of wolves. They were quite concerned about because of the loss of livestock. So they did a program where they took some urban kids from a Portland high school, and they stayed with Grant County ranchers for couple of weeks, and they came away with an understanding, at least, that life was not as simple as that they would have liked to have thought it was.
Right.
It was very well done.
Yeah, I think in the land use sense, I think for me personally, it was interesting because I came from Douglas County and then got the job here at the department, and I was always able to see, I call it kind of the pebble in the pond. I could see the ripple effects of changes that were made to laws up here and what they actually did on the ground out there.
Yeah.
And I've always valued that experience because I think one of my roles in the department was to say, whoa, here for a second, let's talk through this because I know what it's going to do on the ground.
They need that.
They do.
And they do need that.
And we ended up with a real good mix, I think, with the agency. In fact, I kind of credit Jim Ross a little bit. I think he wanted to get a little more of the folks that had been out there working on, with the land use program at various capacities, and some pre-Senate Bill 10 people, Senate Bill 10 people and pre-SB 100 people, and brought them together. And through the actual years of the acknowledgement, I think we had a good group of folks who had both those that were great. We had some really good policy people that had great minds for looking and great vision of how they saw the program being implemented, and mix that with the folks that had some of the experience of what it meant. So,
well, this is a good effort.
Yeah.
I appreciate your doing it.
Well, I appreciate you very much for coming. Thank you. I guess I'll go ahead.